Hi, everybody. This is Pastor Steve, and I'm really glad that you're with us as we step into our second part of this six-part series about Captivated. And I've heard a lot of great reports already about the different meeting gatherings and the things that are happening. And obviously, there is just a beautiful sense of God's presence in our church services as we gather together and in our home groups as people are coming and celebrating relationship, getting to know each other, even just developing those places of greater intimacy in our walk with God and even a deeper relationship with each other. So it's been an amazing few days, hasn't it? And we're looking forward to all the things that God has for us today. And I want to talk to you about one of my favorite topics as we're on the theme of being captivated. Today is all about journeying in your life, taking hold and fulfilling the call of God upon your life. And I want to talk to us today about how every single one of us are called in ministry. Every single one of us, whether we're pastors, evangelists, missionaries, teachers, prophets, you know, all these different places. And then there is the full operational body of Christ. Every one of us, no matter where you are in your walk with God, there's a place for you to begin to fulfill His destiny and His purpose. So if you have your Bibles, I want you to grab them, open up your devices. We're going to take a look at a short passage of Scripture, but it is so power-packed and really full of a life calling that will take our entire lives to truly fulfill. So we're going to go to Matthew chapter 28, and we're going to look today at verse 16 and following. Here's what the Bible says. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Like I said, just a few passages of scriptures, but some of the most important words that Jesus would speak. Jesus is speaking to his disciples as they had gone back up into Galilee, the region where so much of Jesus' ministry had taken place. And Jesus gives them this final call to go into all the world and to preach the good news. And he talks to them about baptizing people in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So it was so important that they had theology, that they would understand the Godhead, the mystery of the Father, the Son, and the working of the Holy Spirit, as we were talking about last week as we gathered together. And in the midst of this, that baptism is a place of developing true disciples, because baptism symbolically links us with everything that Jesus was about. It links us with his redemptive work, that when he went to the cross and as he died upon the cross, he was buried. And then on the third day, he was raised from the dead. And so symbolically, that's what happens with water baptism. We identify with Jesus. We identify with what he did for us on the cross to remove our sin from us. And that when Jesus came out of the water, it represented new life. And as he ascended to the Father, it represents his ongoing victory as he's even praying and interceding for you and me. This is what we have to look forward to today. Our God, who loves us so much that he wants to have this relationship with us that is so deep, so close, and so real by the power of the Holy Spirit. So Jesus said to each one of them, "I want you to go in the world and I want you to preach. I want you to baptize and I want you to make disciples." Making disciples and bringing the word and the good news of Jesus is something every one of us needs to see as a true calling upon our heart. That every one of us have gifts and talents and skills, but beyond that, God has also given us relationships. So just think about this. Your talents, your interests, your jobs take you to different places. So it's like we gather on a Saturday or Sunday as the body of Christ, and we gather now in homes. And then as our lives get lived, we go out into all the world. Isn't that true? And as we go forth, we're going into every sector of the world. We're going into the education field. We're going into the areas of government. We're interacting in our community. Some of you are business leaders. Others of you are people that are working within a business system. But all through that, you have relationships. They're at different places. They're at different statues, different conversations, different places. But through it all, we ought to be speaking and living our relationship with Jesus unto others. And our walk, you know, what it's been said before is, you know, preach Christ and use words if you need to. But there's just so many ways that through our lifestyle, through living with integrity, through being a person that's got a generous spirit, a joyful heart. I mean, every place we go, we should elevate that room, don't you think? We should elevate those relationships because of Christ living inside of us and the power of the Holy Spirit operating in us. And so I want you to see that when the Holy Spirit is teaching us the Word, when the Holy Spirit is alive in our worship, and when we're seeking the Holy Spirit, we get up and start our day off and we're saying, Holy Spirit, I want you to walk with me today. Holy Spirit, I want you to prompt me. You know, when I see things that normally would frustrate me or things that I might otherwise overlook, Lord, prompt me in those moments that I wouldn't allow a great opportunity with somebody in my life to just go by, but you would awaken me in the moment. You would quicken it to me that, wow, here's a great moment just to share a nugget of truth. Here's a moment just to share what you've done in my life. And if every one of us, over 2,000 people strong out of Eastridge, going out in the community, think about what we could do in the boardrooms of corporations, in the classrooms, whether it's junior high, high school, college, wherever it is. Think about the relationships at Starbucks or the places where we're interacting with people. How about those of you who your kids are involved with sports and the conversations that take place on the sidelines or in the stands or so many different places that our lives get lived out. We need to bring the sense of calling and urgency into every single day. And if we would do that, we would find the most exciting things in our life is really when we're giving our talents and we're giving our jobs, our careers unto God. And I don't know if you've ever done this. Maybe you've never prayed for God to use your job. Maybe you've never prayed for God to use you to build His kingdom. And I'm just saying to you that the most exciting life that you could ever live is the one that is fully committed, captivated by the call of God, where you're praying about it, where you're leaning into it, where you're doing things like right now, where you're in a life group or you're coming to some of our teaching and our trainings, and you're just saying, Lord, equip my life, use me. And then there's a whole nother side of this, and that is your personal prayer time, your communion with God, you getting in the Word, you worshiping. You know, I think too often we're just caught up in our busyness, we're caught up in the demands of our lives, when we need that time to quiet our hearts and still our voices sometimes. Listen to worship and to praise and to get into the Word. Say, God, speak to me. And you'll be amazed at how God can speak creativity. He can give you dreams and ideas. He can just really direct your path. And He can even change your attitude as you pray and as you worship, where maybe you've got a bad attitude about where you work. You may feel like you're at a dead end. I want to encourage you to just begin to pray for the people around you. Pray for opportunities. Pray for God to speak to you. And it may be God wants to move you on, but it may be that He wants to grow you right where you are. And, you know, He wants our lives to be lived with purpose. So be prayerful and just say, God, I'm asking you to put me in a place where I can flourish, where I can grow, where I can prosper, where you'll meet my needs and expand my life. But Lord, where I can bear the fruit of the kingdom, where I can really do some things that are effective for you and really make a difference. Prayer changes everything. Never forget that. In our walk with God, if we're just inviting God every day, you know, when we get up in the morning, we spend some time with God, we pray, we just start our day off, even, you know, in the midst of your commute, whatever it is, it's the reality of your life, you know, open up the doors for God to be able to speak. Dream some big dreams with God. I want to just say this to you. God's dreams for us are bigger than the ones we could get on our own. I just think back about when I was a young guy, I was fishing in Alaska on my dad's boat. Some of you have heard me tell this story, but we were on a trip where normally we made a lot of money fishing. We did really well. But on this particular trip, there would be a life-changing trip for me. We were just, you know, fishing 20 miles of gear a day, working ourselves to the bone, and we were pulling up basically nothing but empty hooks. And as a crew member, we were even looking at going up there, working our tails off, and actually losing money in the midst of it. And my dad decided to make a move. We hauled up all of our gear and we're gonna travel for 24 hours and just go to out on the Aleutian Islands and take one more stab at trying to rescue that trip. The weather was bad. The boat was just, you know, moving in the midst of these heavy seas. The only benefit was only one guy had to be on wheel watch, and all the rest of us, after working 20 hours a day, we could get just a little bit of sleep. So we jumped into our bunks and packed ourselves in with blankets and pillows and even life jackets so we wouldn't get pitched out of our bunks in the midst of the rough seas. And myself and others, we just went immediately to sleep because we were just exhausted. And while I was sleeping, God gave me a dream. And in that dream, I saw myself preaching. And it was outdoors. I couldn't tell you if it was a large high school or just a small college, but there was a grandstand and there was a cinder area, cinder rock track, and then an infield. And I had never thought about being a preacher, didn't want to be a preacher, wasn't on my list, but God was giving me an encounter in the Gulf, or I should say out by the Aleutians in the Gulf of Alaska. And he spoke to me in the midst of that dream. And I knew it wasn't just a dream. I knew there was a witness. There was something inside of me that was so profound that I knew it was a call of God on my life. I was preaching. People were coming out of those stands, crossing this cinder rock, coming into this infield. And, you know, I just knew that God was dealing with me. And I saw God answer some prayers. I was dealing with him. I started negotiating. I said, God, you know, if you want me to go to seminary, if you want me to go to Northwest and prepare myself for ministry, I'm sure not making any money on this trip. And it was like God said, money, is that it? Is that the deciding factor? I can handle that. And as we stopped and we dropped our gear and we began to haul the gear the next day, we began to catch fish like nothing I had ever seen. And we did tremendous. In just a few days, we filled our boat, something so out of the ordinary, unbelievable. And it was just a witness to me of God's hand upon my life. And yet at the same time, I was a young guy battling with my own dreams, my own aspirations, and I suppressed what God was saying into my heart. I just went back and I bought a building, I bought a new motorcycle, and I was just going about my life. But as I would go to church and I would sit in church, my pastor could be preaching about anything, and I only heard one thing, and that is, you're out of the will of God. You're supposed to be preparing your life to go and to share Christ and to make a difference. What are you doing here? You're out of the will of God. And I went to my pastor one day and I told him about this conflict that was going on in my life. And I said, you know, I just don't know what to do. I feel like God spoke this to me, but you know, I never thought about this. It wasn't my dreams. It wasn't my plan. I'm just not sure exactly what to do. And my pastor gave me some very simple but absolutely profound information. He said this: you need to just get moving. You need to start moving towards what God said to you, because it's easier to steer a car once it's moving. You just need to get going. And that is so true. I just went back and I prayed. I asked God even for one more sign. He gave me a spectacular confirmation one more time that he was really, you know, wanting me to go into ministry. And so I went and opened up that door and I went to Northwest. And out of that, God began just one step after another to lead me into ministry. And it was years later that one day I was at Safeco Field and I was preaching one of our jamming events. There was a big stage and platform out at second base of Safeco Field. And while I was preaching and giving the altar call, it just struck me that day that people were coming out of the grandstand. They were walking across this cinder rock area and coming into that grassy area. And I just thought to myself, isn't it amazing that years ago in the Aleutian Islands, God spoke to a young 19-year-old kid about just trusting him, just dreaming, and just, you know, pursuing his will and his call. And I want to say this to you today. You might be, God may have you on the business track. He might have you in education. He might have you in government, wherever it is. You might be a student at school. You might be an athlete. Whatever it is, I just want you to know the most important thing is to say yes to God. And to realize you've been called to go into all the world. That means where you live. That means even a vision to go to the far corners of the earth as well as across the street. And if you and I will just get involved, you will see God do some amazing things. There's just a whole amazing work that the Lord is doing right now with our children's ministry. Our youth ministry is going great. You know, God may speak to you about being an usher. He might speak to you about being somebody out in the parking lot. Or he might talk to you about teaching. We're starting to expand our ministry to businessmen and women. Maybe God would just have you come and lead a group. Just be a part of a group. There's so much to be done. But here's how relationship always functions. It functions through relationship. And as you just say, God, use me. Holy Spirit, come into my life. Speak to me. And take that first simple step. You know, it might be that, you know, serving in children's ministry, just coming and being a part, you would just find God use you in great ways. Maybe you have musical gifts and skills, technical skills. I mean, there is something for you. Maybe you're a script writer, you're a drama person. And I mean, the doors are wide open. The most important thing is dare to get involved and realize you are called. You are called. It's part of your life. It's part of your DNA. Every single follower of Jesus has a role that is specific and is important. And if you will just step in, He'll begin to direct the path. And even if God takes you a totally different direction, it's going to all be because you chose to get involved. There's nothing greater than the body of Christ. There's no higher calling in any of our lives than to help build the body of Christ. You and I have been given a great task. Eastridge Church is a great church. It's a great family, and God has even more for us. But we need every one of us to be on that growth plane. We need to be leaning into God, believing, seeking, and taking that first step. Our facilitator is going to come. I want to encourage everybody, get in this conversation. Talk about God's prompting. Talk about God's answering prayer. Talk about fears that you might even have, things that are germinating in your life, and let God do some great things. I appreciate you being here. I'm excited that you're a part of our life groups. Have a great time.